highlight it, get as early as possible, get involved, try to get representation there so that the policies are fully inclusive and they include what's needed around performance and immunity of drugs. Recommendation 6 is fairly similar to before, but just briefly, just sort of reworded. It's about providing a full mix of services. So if you're not familiar with them, there is the same as before, there's three levels. Level 1 is simple distribution, usually in packs, with written information on pharmacology, and that's it. And that's what a lot of providers, particularly pharmacy providers, do. Level 2 is a bit more bespoke, it's a pick and mix approach. This is where clients can come in and select particular things they may need, so there's some calculations that John mentioned earlier. They can actually work out exactly what they need to make sure you're providing exactly the right sort of mix of needs, experience, and paraphernalia as well. They also include referral services and health promotion advice on top of the written information about how to do it. Some level 2 services also offer the virus test and vaccination. Level 3 services, these are should include everything in level 2, and referral and or provision themselves are more specialist services, so these are the sort of things where there's a specialist clinic where somebody can sit down and chat through what they're using, get advice about the specifics of it. Recommendation 7, this is about providing the right equipment and advice. This is where there's an opportunity for specialist services around giving advice about dosing, that sort of thing fits in. Advice on how to reduce harm. I'll recognise that the typical message you would get in an inhaled syringe program of reduce injecting and reduce drug use, but if you can't stop using your drug and switch to an oral form, it does not necessarily apply to steroid users, because switching to an oral form increases that harm caused by the drug itself. Although it reduces harms from injecting, it actually reduces different harms. So it's about making sure that the message that gets across is clear and appropriate. So again, and it's addressing the health thing as well, again, it's all about getting involved with the service planning and trying to make sure that the specialist services are in the right place in the right settings. Recommendation 8, this is specifically focused on community pharmacy-based inhaled syringe programs. I'm a pharmacist, and I have my background in this area comes from. I think it's very important that community pharmacy is overlooked from the performance of inhaled syringe drugs point of view. Although most pharmacies would not provide specialist services, and many would be level 1, I think it's important if you're working with people who inject performance enhancing drugs to engage with pharmacy providers to make sure that the people working there are aware of what's going on. They have competence to give the sort of advice that's needed. Basic advice, not that they should be experts, but they should be able to give a simple answer to a simple question and know where they can refer somebody if it's a complex question. Okay? Pharmacies have much less stigma, as I mentioned. As much as stigma is important for younger people, it may well also be important for some of the people who are using performance enhancing drugs. Talk about perhaps some olanzapine injectors. It's very difficult, it may be very difficult for some of them to acknowledge that they are an injecting drug user and that they fit into a similar category in terms of risk as somebody injecting heroin. So accessing a service in a traditional needle syringe program might be quite difficult. Going to a pharmacy is something they already do. They go on by paracetamol, or they buy all sorts of things from a pharmacy. So the stigma difference is quite important. Pharmacies, if you can engage with them and you can support them, they are likely to be a good source of referrals into the specialist services. So if you're looking to raise awareness, my advice would be to engage with the pharmacy providers locally. Recommendation 9 is about specialist level 3 services. These are the high-level services where it might be about sexual health, mental health, and it also specifically mentions services to... I should have said earlier, IPED was the term that we finally settled on. We tried lots of different ones, but image and performance enhancing drugs appears to be... Well, it was in mode when we decided. It may well have changed by next week. It seems to move around a little bit. But it's IPED all the way through this. So services for IPED users is specifically mentioned as one of the level 3 services. Because one of the things I wanted to say, recommendation 10 fits, this is specifically aimed at IPED users. One of the things I wanted to say that's why some of the recommendations are a little bit scant in detail, because the evidence wasn't there for us to make very strong recommendations. In terms of the provision of these services, they should be provided at times and locations that meet the needs of people who inject imaging and performance enhancing drugs. I've emphasised inject there, because that's what it specifically says. We are talking about using the screening programmes, so although a lot of the specialist services out there are actually very holistic and you can do lots of different advice for people using a range of different forms of imaging enhancing drugs, the needle and syringe program guidance is particularly focused on injecting. Okay? So it's about making services available outside of normal working hours, because a lot of this population will have a full-time job and may struggle to access the services if they're in normal working hours. And also, we included a recommendation around how many detached services perhaps going to gyms, that sort of thing. It was about providing the right equipment, the right information, the right advice, and making sure the staff were appropriately trained to give advice on the full range of drugs out there, that they're not just a little bit familiar with steroids and that's the extent of their knowledge. As Martin said this morning, the range of things that are being used is quite wide. And it's really just making sure that the staff in the specialist services actually have a breadth of knowledge rather than just having a focus on one thing. And sometimes that knowledge might actually be knowing where to refer somebody to. So knowing somebody locally or even somebody nationally where you can find that bit of information out and say, come back next week, I'll have some more information about next week. And then for the specialist services, this was a specialist in inverted commas, a few specialists in a few places. This is where it's a level 2 or 3 service where there's a high proportion of IPED using clients. And again, this is all from the data from the that seems to be everybody in the Northwest. Because most of them seem to have a high proportion of IPED using clients, which creates a challenge when you start becoming specialist. This is about making sure that they've got the right information, the right skills and competence amongst their staff to provide advice on imaging performance enhancing drugs, side effects, and alternatives as well, and recognising alternatives such as nutrition and physical training. Can be an option to somebody, and sometimes, in some cases, particularly if somebody's just initiating use, it may be that they can get a really a response that they're very happy with through just using nutrition training, and actually no need to move on to performance enhancing drugs so early. Also, it's about making sure information provided and the referral. And my advice again is about reaching out to all the service providers that you're working with specialist service and making sure they know how to get. They know how to send somebody else to see you, and they've got the right information, leaflets, cards, whatever, that they can help you to refer people into your service. And I would say as pharmacists, particularly community pharmacy is a place where those sorts of questions will be raised, and pharmacists may not know where to send people in every case.